Hello everybody, this is Alex with part two of our capital team video. And we're gonna dig in a little bit more today. We're gonna explain the difference between what a public offering is, a 506B, 506C, and equity crowdfunding. So those are the different ways that you can essentially give away equity for your company. There are a bunch of other ones, but we're gonna stick to those since that's what our business is dealing with and what the majority of businesses are dealing with now. So most of you are probably familiar with a public offering. So that's what you hear about with the New York Stock Exchange. That's what you hear these big companies doing with. And that's really more of a long-term strategy for a huge company that's already been out there. There's all sorts of work that has to go into it. It literally costs hundreds of thousands or even millions of dollars to be able to do something like that. So that's not really an option for smaller businesses looking for funding. That's after they've already hit the home run. That's after you have investors on board and you want to really get them to have a way to make a lot of money on their own. So to not do a public offering, you need to fall under a certain exemption, okay? So the public offerings, they're so expensive because you really have to support and do lots of due diligence to such an intense level to get there. So to be exempt from following those tons of rules, you have to file as a 506B, 506C, or equity crowdfunding option. So with 506B, last video we talked a little bit about whether somebody's an accredited investor or an unaccredited investor. 506B allows you to actually get both. You're limited for the unaccredited investors to 35. And again, with everything in the video, check with a lawyer. This stuff is changing all the time. Lots of this hasn't been changed in the last couple of months. But as it stands right now, you can take on people that have not proven that they're accredited investors. And also, you don't need a third party to verify that they're an accredited investor as you would with 506C. So 506C, they actually have to go to a lawyer or accountant or something to prove their value, to prove that they would not be hurt by investing in something like this. Another difference between 506B and 506C, 506B, you cannot generally solicit. So you wouldn't be able to make a video or do an advertisement or get outside anyone that's somehow affiliated with your social circle. So it's relying a little bit on your knowledge of them and making sure that that's okay. Whereas with 506C, there's a little bit more leeway. They're still limited as to how that they can get the word out. It's called tombstone ads. You don't really get into that, but you can do a little bit more solicitation with 506C. And equity crowdfunding, this is brand new. This is something that hasn't even been out for a year yet, and only a handful of companies have even done it successfully. You might see a whole bunch of portals out there starting to do this kind of thing, but when you guys hear crowdfunding, you might think something like Kickstarter, right? So Kickstarter, you essentially give money to a company, and you're gonna end up getting part of a product later on, should it come to fruition. With equity crowdfunding, you're giving money, but then you own part of the company. So it's a little bit different there. This is something that's brand new. With equity crowdfunding, you're allowed to take unaccredited investors, actually. But there's a whole slew of rules that you have to be able to meet. It's not quite as extensive as a public offering by any means, but there's what's called a PPM, a private placement memorandum, that is, it can cost anywhere from $15,000 to $50,000 for an attorney to be able to handle that kind of thing for you. So it does get up there a little bit, and it limits how much that they can invest quite a bit too. But if you want to be able to get 1,000 tiny investors, there's equity crowdfunding. From the people in my investment circles, this is somewhat of a wild card. Since it's so new, we don't know how people are going to handle it. We don't know how unaccredited investors are going to handle things also. Are they going to be calling the company every week wanting to know how their investment is because they're a little bit less business savvy? Is their tiny $1,000 investment, are they going to be more likely to take you to court because they thought that they were promised a home run or whatever it might be? Which, by the way, you can't do for any of these. The SEC won't allow you to promise anything or promise returns or give you guarantees of any sort. But once you start getting into unaccredited investors who haven't done this before, it's a big question mark, is the thing. So those are the big ways right now that you can raise capital. Essentially with, there are also what's called notes or loans. That is different than equity because you have to pay that back. So generally this is where it's like a standard loan. You get a certain percentage over time when the person pays you back. And if there is the term convertible, that means it starts out as debt and then they can convert that into equity. So there are optional convertible notes where they can choose to either get money back or equity. There's mandatory convertible notes. There's a whole slew of options in between there. But when you're raising money for your company, those are the big ones. Are you raising debt? Are you gonna pay that back later with money? Or are you paying that back with equity? Those are really the big things you have to think about there. So here's something that's a little bit counterintuitive for people that I'll jump into, especially those of you that think you understand how to value a business. And that's something that entrepreneurs and investors are constantly fighting over. And when you see those valuations on TV, that is definitely an investor-friendly version there. But for those of you that are entrepreneurs that are looking to get out there, when you're raising money, you need to raise $1 million or more to be successful. If you think you can get by and doing less than that, you need to figure out a way to bootstrap it and do it on your own and not bring on investors. Because when you bring on investors, you owe it to them to give them a home run. The way it breaks down for them, since most companies fail, out of every 10 companies they invest in, about 5 or 6 of them, they're gonna fail. They're 100% losing their money, no matter how good the idea or how good the team. 2, maybe 3 of those are gonna break even, maybe make a little bit of money. And maybe 2 of those will be home runs that make up for the whole other 10. So you need to be able to show them, when you're raising money, how they're gonna be able to potentially 50x their money. Of course, you can't promise this to them, but you need to be able to show that that's a possibility. And to be able to do anything like that, you need an intense team. Forget the overhead that's hundreds of thousands of dollars, or the insurance, the administrative staff, all the different technology and systems you're gonna need in place. Talk about the executives that you're going to need that have the expertise to get you to 50x their money really quickly. So you're going to need the chief operating officer, maybe a chief technical officer, or a chief marketing officer. It depends on your business. Each one's going to be a little bit different, but you're most likely bringing on 2, 3, 4 executives in the beginning. They're all having their team too. And to be able to have somebody that can 50x the money with a reasonable chance of hitting that, they're going to be expensive. Okay, so I know you guys hear stories of people essentially being paid nothing and getting 1,000x their money. That is not regular. Okay, so you're gonna need pros, you're gonna need teams, you have tons of overhead, and you're gonna be failing and pivoting constantly until you get that sweet spot. But that's what you need to be able to do to show them that this is a good chance at a home run. And the statistic, last time I checked, for those businesses that are raising capital and that raise less than 1 million, they have a 1 in 25 chance of success. Because what ends up happening is they spend their money too quickly and then they don't have a complete product. And then what ends up happening when they need to go back, let's say they only raised $500,000 and now it's $500,000, let's say, and just one executive and their team eats up most of that. Plus you only have a partially developed product, you don't have anything to bring to market, and now you need to go ask for investors. Those investors aren't gonna jump on board because they saw you chew through that $500,000 and they think their $500,000, the exact same thing's gonna happen. You have no track record for success and there's no way you're getting that Series B equity raise after you've done something like that. So if you're raising money, you need to raise 1 million or more. If you can't, then don't. Go ahead and bootstrap it on your own until that's a commitment you're willing to make. So that's all I've got for you guys today. Thank you, and go to businessfundwithalex.com if you'd like to be a part of the capital team that mentioned in video 1, and we can dig in and be a little bit more personal there too. Thanks, guys.